In name of all of you, I want to congratulate the organizers for this nice conference. Really grateful conference, in fact. And okay, and today I will talk about this value filtering in two different proposals. Okay, I feel like uncomfortable in the sense that, okay, it's too loud. How can I do this? Okay, that's too loud. So I feel a little uncomfortable in the sense that maybe it's out of the scope of most of your work that works in thermal transporting. But okay, I try to present my results that was published in two papers, in PRB papers. And these two proposals, it's using the advantage of this new degree of freedom, the value, and similar as charges for electronics and spin as for spintronics, you have value for valuetronics. So I also would like to thank my collaborators. This guy is from University of Antwerp, where I spent 1.5 years during my PhD. I just got recently my PhD. And nowadays I'm working as a postdoc research in the Federal University of Ceará, and who's my two supervisors are Julia Aquino Farias and André Chaves. These two PhD students are here. So we bring with me in order to join this nice conference. So, the great interest in work with this huge 2D family is not the possibility to use this in technological applications, but also in the sense that you can, it allows to check quantum theory phenomena. So this is due to the fact that electrons in this, at least in graphene, it behaves like massless Dirac fermions. So it obeys the Dirac equation, and so it behaves like a quasi-relativistic particle. And in this sense, this can predict some phenomena described by for the quantum field theory. So beyond this motivation, most of this published paper during this last decades is related to a great improvement in experimental techniques that can cut graphene and different carbon-based materials in different ways and with different shapes, with different edges. And so it's open the mind of many theoretical groups to to simulate very different and strange possible devices that maybe in the near future can be realized. So another index that shows how this 2D materials is a hot topic. You can see many covers of really important journals like Science in Nature, Photonics, Nature, Physics. So this boom in scientific community started in 2004 with graphene isolation. And in my point of view, the most important feature of this isolation, it's showed to community that other 2D materials are possible and stable. So another index that show how it's hot topic and how is the growing of this research area it shows the number of publication per year and the number of patents. And all these three carbon-based materials, you can see that all of them are the number of patents and number of the publication are increasing. So beyond the papers and patents, another amount that emphasize how important is this for the community scientific is that when involve money. So the European Commission invest in this graphene flagship program around 1 billion euro to spend in 10 years. So many companies, many public and private universities are studying and developing research in this area that was open with the isolation of the graphene in 2004. So this is my only joke in this. And it's famous not only in scientific community, but also around the world. And as presented in this slide, there's some snapshots of this episode for this very famous comedian TV called it the Big Bang Theory. So, but the motivation directly related with my work is according to this new degree of freedom that it's basic, the fact that graphene has two no equivalent direct cones, K and K prime, and so this way you have these two different values of possibility. And many groups during this past decade has proposed different sketches for to achieve this valley filtering. One of these is this Nature paper. I think it's one of the first ones. It's 2007. But you see that they demand a high control, demand a high control how to cut the graphene flake in order to obtain all of these edges to be zigzag. So with this constraint and zigzag edges, they achieve this valley filtering. Another proposal was reported in the group of Tony Low and Paco Guinea, was if you apply a certain kind of strain, you have also valley filtering. In many papers, has been published by considering defect lines. So one, two, I can show many of papers, at least I know six or seven papers that use the same kind of idea, this defect line, to in order to achieve this this valley filtering. So let's move to my two proposals. In contrast to this other proposal that need a specific kind of edges, a very simple proposal that we think if you have a bilayer system and if you apply bias potential in such way that you have a constriction and you have a channel with unbiased channel. So if you have this aligned potentials in each layer, you obtain like a usual quantum point contact. On the other hand, if you take opposite gates in the opposite side of your sample, what you obtain, I will show in the next slide, you obtain a chiral, one direction chiral state for each valley. That means that in each valley, what you have it's an electron that has a, for instance, in K a positive group velocity and in K prime a negative group velocity. So in, okay. I did this for AB stacking. actually, it matters how is the spectrum when, I mean, the spectrum relation, and I will show this in the next slide. So because since that AB stacking has parabolic, and you apply this bias, we open a gap, and we create a barrier here and a barrier here, but you have an unbiased channel here. So, and for this situation, and once that it's parabolic, it will open a gap, and you obtain this chiral state. I'm not sure if you take AA stacking, but I think it will hold also. And the other proposal is take this kind of S-shaped strain, and that corresponds to circular strain, make a like a S, and how valley filtering works here is the combination of two effects. The first one that I will show the papers that it was in 2010. A Nature paper that shows that if you apply strain in graphene, your electrons behave as they were in unstressed flake, but under the presence of a pseudomagnet field. And they show that this pseudomagnet field point towards different opposite direction and K and K prime. So have this in mind, and in the fact that you have here two different strain, you create like a pseudomagnet kink barrier. So we have like a state that you propagate from the left to the right, in a trajectory that looks like a snake state. So as a standard outline, I will present the theoretical tools you use it in both works. I'll try not to bother you with the three first points. I decided to keep it since it has a status of a school, but I realized that most of you are really expertise in this theme, so I try to be really brief in this part and focus a little more and give more details about this split operator technique. I didn't mention yet, but in these two proposals, what you use is we describe electron as a Gaussian wave packet, and this Gaussian wave packet is propagate in time by solving the time dependent radio equation. So in contrast to the previous work, as Alexandre showed in the last week, that shows Landau Boothke formalism. This one that I use in these two works, they are very simple. Just solve time dependent radio equation and use a Gaussian wave package to describe electrons. So, as everyone here in this audience know, graphene has two atoms in the unit cell. It can be described by two primitive vectors, and it's a honeycomb lattice. It's not a Bravais lattice, and so on and so forth. I'll not bother you with this so trivial stuff for you. And okay, our model in the both works that we use is Titan bind model. So here we have the on-site energy, and this part corresponds to the link with the nearest neighbor atoms. So apply magnet field in this model. It's similar as a Hopping transformation that is described by this spiral substitution. So given by where this A is the vector potential. In a similar way, and it's easy to think about it, if you apply strain, you have a lattice deformation. And once that you have a lattice deformation, the distance between the atoms are different, you change. And once that it change, the hope energy should also change. So in similar way, apply strain in the graphene, in graphene and other carbon, I mean in bilayer graphene, trilayer graphene, it's similar as change the hope energy. So this basic concepts that I gave you, and also in this slide, in the next one, is just to in order to my presentation be constant. Once that you have a tight bind model, magnet field and strain are included in the model by transformation of the hope energy. And here is just to show that from the 6 point that the conduction and valence band touch each other, these two of them are no equivalent. So this K, K prime, it's the two cones that, I mean, the low energy electrons are in this region. So they are described by this Jericho equation, as I told you in the second slide. It's like a massless Jericho famous. So it's described by this equation that it's linear in momentum. And once that it has two atoms per unit cell, you can describe the wave function as the pseudo-spinor, where phi A and phi B are the probability to find electrons and the sublattice A and B. So, and when they are peeling graphite, you can achieve these two layers, two graphene layers that are called bilayer graphene. And our model, in tight bind model, you just use the perpendicular hoping. So, and you use AB stacking. In Jericho description, you have this four-band Hamiltonian. It's a 4x4 Hamiltonian, where this P and P daga are the momentum operators. So maybe you also know this. When you apply perpendicular electric field and bilayer graphene, you open a gap, as you can see here, and include this in Jericho model is just put this diagonal terms. It's really easy to do this. And this was obtained in 2009 in an experimental paper that shows this, in fact, this occurred. So this is the technique that I use for time propagation. We solve this time-dependent Schrödinger equation, where the general solution is given by this way: a time after is it's equal time evolution operator times a wave in a time before, where this time evolution operator is given by this exponential. It's in Sakurai book, and if it can be written by this way, if this Hamiltonian does not depend explicitly on time, as I wrote here. So once that you know that most of, in general, this Hamiltonian, it's given by the kinetic and potential part, and in general, it does not commute. Once this does not commute, so we cannot simply apply this fair to that. It's just you can, in order to expand this exponential as two, the multiplication of two exponential. We cannot do it in general because the Hamiltonian, as I said you, the kinetic and the potential part does not commute. So what you have to do is what this technique name says. We split the time evolution operator in order to do it more easily computationally. So the forms that you do it is like this, and also use the Cayley relation. In our work, we have different ways to expand the exponential, but the one that we use in both works is like this one, as expressed here. And the error is in the order of delta t power of 3. So if you assume very small time steps, it's not a problem. So, and with this, if you apply, if you discretize your space, and you can multiply directly the wave function with this first explanation. And for the connective part, you can use Cayley form. And again, for the third part, you can just multiply directly, point by point. So at the end, you end up with just multiplication of trigonal matrix that it's really easy to implement. So differently from this, for instance, Landau boot formalism and the other ones. So in our work, as ones that use this, the tight binding Hamiltonian, what we just, this slide is just show how we handle this in our code. This is tight binding Hamiltonian that I describe the Hopping energy between the atoms in this lattice, and which of this Hamiltonian it corresponds the Hamiltonian for the for a room and for a column. So and we split the time evolution operator like this way. So maybe you are asking, oh, okay, why are you doing here this expansion? Once that you don't have, I mean, the terms commute, but we did this here because at the beginning we have a pentadiagonal matrix in blocks. So, but if you do this, you have just trigonal matrix, multiplication of trigonal matrix. So it's using this, you can apply for really large system, and you don't take much of, for instance, RAM memory of your computer. So an important point in our model is how take the initial wave packet, I mean the initial wave function. And what we did, and we considered this circular symmetric Gaussian distribution, and where this x0 and y0, it's the center of the Gaussian. And more important is this pseudo spindle, because it's related to the direction of propagation. Once that this pseudo spindle is characterized by the pseudo spin polarization angle, because this pseudo spindle in general it's given by this, where this angle, it's the propagation angle, and it gives the direction how you want to propagate in your system. So for instance, if you take like phi equal to zero, you propagate in x direction. If you take a phi equal to pi, you propagate in the perpendicular direction of this. So, and what you do, we choose this Gaussian wave packet close to the K and K prime points in the beginning of the simulation, first in K, and after that you run, and you do this for in K prime. So, but we located close to the K and K prime points, and we shifted a little in order to give momentum, in order to this wave packet propagate. So here it's a sample where you have like here and here you have an interface between monolayer and bilayer system, and I just show some snapshots of the Gaussian circular Gaussian effect. Sorry for this once that it's not symmetric. I mean the x and y x. Okay, doesn't matter. So and if you take snapshots. You can see that this wave packet propagating, and when you find this interface, part of this are reflecting, part of this are passed through the system. And at this point, it's one of the greatest advantage of this technique, because you can track the center mass of your Gaussian wave packet. You can see if they are scattering, how is scattering in the interface, how is scattering in the edges. You can look for the intra-valley and inter-valley scattering in reciprocal space. And also, it does not take too long to do this, to run it. And it allows also to perform very large system. As you can see here, I think this one is for like in this direction. It's like 5,000 angstrom. So it's a bilayer. So it's many atoms with many connections. And I did this in my laptop. So it's just a couple of minutes. So with this technique, it's really powerful. And some papers has reported and compared this with this Crank-Nielsen technique, with this Chebyshev polynomials, also with this Zandalbut formalism, and show a very good agreement. So, and beyond this, you have this pedagogical advantage that you can, you have more physical meaning to understand the transport properties, as you can see here. So let's start with this first proposal that it's just include electrostatic potential, as I show you, and it can easily perform as in this slide here, that you have bottom and top gates. So it's, I expect that they can, they expect that they do it in the new future because it's simple. And so I will show the two configurations as I told you. In both of them, we obtain steps in the transmission probability as a function of the initial the energy of the initial Gaussian wave packet. And in both cases, when you apply this bias, doesn't matter if you take this in a line way, in anti-aligned way, you open a gap in this region, and you have this unbiased make a constraint as a quantum point contact. So here is this. So answer is directly related with your question. This is for a second that has four bands that are parabolic. So I have to think and check if how it will behave for the AEA stacking. So, but for this case, you obtain this symmetric spectrum that is, this is for, I plot for K, but it's really the same for K prime. And on the other hand, for this case that you have anti-aligned gates, what you obtain, your spectrum have this, has this one direction chiral states. That means that once that I plotted for K, electrons on low energy regime will propagate just with positive group velocity. On the other hand, if I had plotted this the same panel for the K prime, what you obtain it's something like the state is like this. So it's because it's mirror symmetric. It's mirror symmetric, and for the K prime, what you have this chiral states, but with electrons as a negative group velocity. So it suggests us that this anti-aligned situation can be used as a valid filter. Once that, if we start your I mean, if you locate your electron close to the K valley and you propagate it, just, I mean, if you have a mix of K and K prime, just the K will pass through the quantum point contact and K prime will go back, since that K has positive group velocity and K prime has negative group velocity. Is this main idea how this valley filtering works? So the first result is, as I told you, this quantum point contact for the aligned case, you obtain the steps as usual semiconductor quantum point contacts. And okay, and here we can see that it doesn't matter if you take a larger length of the channel, always the step will happen as the same position in the transmission probability. And here this plot is for k, but if you plot for k prime, it will be exactly the same. And the reason is because your energy as a function of momentum, it's symmetric, that you also you have symmetry. Once that, your energy obeys the symmetries. So, and although I don't show here, but it's easy to think. If you have a larger channel width, what you have is the energy will go down. In this sense, this plateau we also going down. You see that I use really basic techniques solving time dependent Schrödinger equation. You obtain very simple results, and that it's really nice, and it was done really fast because this technique it's really powerful. So if you plot the same transmission probability for electrons starting k in k prime, you can check here that the transmission probability has the steps. But the transmission probability for the different values had different values. So it's another indicative that this anti-aligned case can work as a valid filtering, since that the polarization is just done 1 minus the ratio between the transmission probability from a wave vector that starts in k and k prime. So so up to now, what from this point, what you do is we just look for the system parameters that improve this value filtering, and I plot for different channel length and different channel width, and also for different potential barriers. So to obtain what we obtain is if you for all of this channel width, if we increase this bias potential, your transmission for k and k prime, here's for k and k prime, open and close and open symbols. So all the transmissions, it's decreasing. And the reason for its decreasing is very simple also. You are increasing the height of the barrier. So more part of the wave packet will be reflected. And you also can see in this panels is that if we increase this bio potential, your polarization will achieve the value close to 1 in some case, and when you increase the channel length, it will converge to 1 and keep in 1. So it means that this system works as a value filtering, and the parameters need to be in such a way that your channel should be large enough as I go increasing, the polarization will increase. And you also can see from this picture, for instance, if you decrease, this one is for 20 nanometers, if you decrease the channel width, the polarization also increases. So you need a narrow channel width and a very long, a narrow and long channel. So just to confirm this, I plot this transmission probability and polarization for different values of, increasing the channel width. And you see that when you increase it, you suppress this polarization, as I told you. So as conclusion for this first part of the work, you see that if you take asymmetric configuration for your bias gates, you obtain like this. You obtain a symmetric spectrum, and that for K and K prime, and you have in the low energy regime your charge carriers, you have the same you have a positive group velocity for one K and negative for the other one. So it showed that this system worked as a valid filtering, and this parameter system should be in such a way that the width of the channel should be narrow, and the length of the channel should be larger. So this paper was published in PRB at the end of last year. And I will move for the next proposal that's based on that a graphene nanoribbon with a certain kind of strain. So first off, start my result in this part. I need to show some couple of papers that give the base concepts related to my proposal. So the first one was published in Science in 2010, and where they done some spectroscopic measurements using STM microscopy, and they show that there's nanobubbles that form in the structure. You have like very large pseudomagnet field, greater than 300 teslas. It was done by the group of Castro Neto and Paco Guinea, and they also did a theoretical. They also provide a theoretical framework, and they obtain almost good qualitative results that shows again that you can achieve in this close to this nanobubble. This is the perfil. You can obtain very large pseudomagnet field. So you can keep this in mind that strain in graphene induce pseudomagnet field. And the other paper was this Nature Physics, and they show in this paper that this strain induced this pseudomagnet field induced by strain points in different directions, as you can see here, in different directions in the two jerk cones. So instead of points towards the same direction as a normal external magnet field. So, and the other paper that was also published in 2010 for Paco Guinea again, is they show that if you assume uniform or almost uniform pseudomagnet field, they show how to map it and obtain the lattice deformation that it's this UX and UY for these two cases. So in our work, what we assume is this kind of lattice deformation that it's almost that generate almost uniform pseudomagnet field. And so again to this picture to show how is the proposal, and the system parameters of our system is the length of the scattering region and the radius of the circular deformation. And I have to point out that I have to emphasize that you have here a circular deformation that change the radius sign when they cross this dashed green line. So here it's for instance negative one. So and the idea of this valley filtering for this case, it's the combination of the fact that pseudomagnet field point towards different direction, and the fact that strain and also this one also and this one, that strain generate this pseudomagnet field. So, and if you combine this two filter and you take two circular deformation, you have that electrons that travel from the left to the right. Then you travel around this green line, since that here you have a pseudomagnet kink barrier. So this is the deformation. And in order to make it more realistic, what we assume is a smooth Gaussian variation from that links the input with an output with this scattering region. So this is the other parameter that we play in order to see how is the best setup to provide a very efficient valley filtering. So the circular deformation, it deforms the brilliant zone, and this way they shift the cones. And also, as I show in the theoretical part, this deformation is straining graphene. You change the Hopin parameter, and this way, then you change the effective vector potential, so that it's given by this. So with this, you can simply calculate the pseudomagnet field that we plotted here, just to show you that you have this kink here. Here it's the pseudomagnet field points one direction, and another one in the bottom part points to the opposite direction. So a way to map the strain effects as electron behave is consider that electron behave as an unstressed flake, but with under the presence of magnet field. So we in this slide, in the next one, what I show it's how looks the energy spectrum for K and K prime. Consider this assumption that you can map strain as a magnet field. So once that we are taking the low energy regime, we solve this Dirichlet equation, assume a Landau gauge, and once that you have a translational symmetry along the x direction, kx it's a good quantum number, so you can assume the wave function like this, and with straightforward calculations, you can decoupling these equations for each component, and who's the and the solution are these parabolic cylindric functions. So, if you solve this for the positive part of, I mean, the for positive magnet field and for negative magnet field, since that you have this kink. So and we. You, if you take these two wave functions and the derivative, you have the boundary condition that implies us in this transcendental equation. So this calculation is what performed for the K. So you have this no monatomic decreasing states that all of them in general has negative group velocity. In similar sense as we done, as I mentioned for you, for the previous work. Here, if you solve the same equations, but instead of B, you put plus and minus B, or you do this kind of consideration for the momentum, what you obtain is that the spectrum for K prime, that corresponds to negative pseudomagnet field, you have monatomic increasing energy levels. So again, it suggests that this kind of proposal can be used as a valley filtering, since that electrons in one K has a positive velocity group, and in the another in K prime valley it has negative, for instance, but it's the opposite. So similar work has performed by Francois Pites in 2000, and they claim that the origin of this discretizing energy states are snake state. Okay. The discretizing energy states propagates along the kink. So here is to show that it's what I claim since the beginning, that you have valley filtering by your snake states, is the fact that electrons in our system, we perform a trajectory that is like a snake. With just Lorentz force, you can understand this. And so once that I have just 5 minutes. And what you've done, this next slide, and you also can see in the paper was also published, that we were looking for the parameters that optimize this valley filtering. And what we obtain is that if we increase this scattering region, you will optimize this effect. And so if you want to see in more details, this work is published in this also PRB paper. And maybe some experimental guys here are asking, okay, how can they do it experimentally? Has some papers that claim that you can take a flexible substrate and use some appropriate piezos and you can achieve this kind of sample. So I don't know how to do it. So I just want to acknowledge this, all this foundation and university, and also the organizers, and thank you for your attention.